Odin skipti hönum. Låd og bukrin sem sofin eða daudur. En han var då fugl eða dyr, fisker eða ormur. Og fór og eini svipstund og fjarleg lönd. At sinum erendum eða annara manna. Att kunni han enn att gera med ordum einum. Att slökva eld och kyrra sjå och snua vindum, värja leid är han vildig. Dat kan ekit sjauanda, fxe hovan loga, salum sesmögum. Brennrat svå breit, att ek hanum bjargigak, vann kan ek galder att gala. Dat kan ek it niunda, ef mik neudrum ständer, att bjarga fari mino af floti. Vindek kyrri, vågi å, och svefik allan sä. Brimrunar skal du rista, ef du vilt borgit hafa av sundi segelmärom. A staffni skal da rista, och a stjörnar bladi, och lägga eld i år. Eras var bratter bräki, näs var blår unner, då komst du heil av hafi. Hrimgerder kvad, trennar niunder möja, då reid ein fyr, vit und hjalmi mär. Mari ristutst, stod af män om deira, dögg i djupa dali, hagli hova vido. Dadan kömer med aldom år. Va brål joma af loga fjollom, en af deim ljomom leiptrer kvomo. Da var rundt hjelmom a himing vanga, brynjor vor og deira, blodi stoknar, en af geirom geislar stodo. Svåvar at høyra er saman kvomo, kolgo syster och kiler langir, sem bjorg eda brim brotna mundi. Draga bad helgi, håsegel ofar, vardat rannom hafn thingloga. Då är ogårlig ägis dotter, stagstjörn märom, stöjpa vildi. En daim sjalfum sigrun ofan, folk djörfum berg och far i deira. Snårist ramliga, rånor händi, gjelfurdyr konungs att gnipa lundi. Sviper ein vardat er saman kvomo, fölvir oddar att fräka steini. Øyvar helgi, hunningsbani, fyrster i folki, där er firar bördust. Öster og imo, allträder flugar, så hafti hilmir hart modakarn. Komo där ur himni, hjelmviter åfan, öks geira gnyr. Där er gram i lifto, då kvadat sigrun sårviter fluga, åt holusker af hugens barri.
Whenever I go to sit by the sea and listen to the water, the streams, the waves splashing ashore, I usually think that this is the oldest or one of the oldest sounds on our earth. I have this thing for the ocean. My grandfather was a sailor, his name was Einar. And his father, Ole Henrik, was also a sailor. And his father, Värmund Kvilhaug, was also a sailor. and my grandfather liked to think that his ancestors had been sailors ever since the Viking Age and beyond. That's actually possible because people who have lived in Norway up through time have been extremely dependent on the sea, both for the produce, for food, for traveling, for trading, but also just for getting around, because before roads were invented, because before tunnels were invented, going somewhere by ocean voyage was the easiest and fastest way to get around. And since I come from a family of sailors, I have heard about ocean storms. I've heard about it from men who actually managed to live through it, who survived it. My great-grandfather, Ole Henrik Kvilhaug, got shipwrecked in 1917, around Christmas time, between Japan and Russia. And in order to get back home, he had to take the Trans-Siberian Railway through Russia during the Russian Revolution. And when he finally came back, it took him more than 6 months to come back to Norway. When he finally came back, he was so happy that he made my grandfather, who was born in the summer of 1918. So, I thought to take this talk down to the sea today because we're going to talk about weather control, weather magic. And most of the stories that I'm going to introduce to you to are about ocean storms. Not all, but most. And this was because ocean storms was one of the greatest dangers that people back then experienced. So, imagine a world where nature is alive. Today, it is easily seen as a thing, something mechanic, something to be used, exploited. Some, of course, have a more romantic approach to nature, often thinking that nature is by nature naturally benign and healthy. And we long to go back to living in harmony with that nature. I often seek out to feel that connection myself. There is a longing there, a wish to be more a part, a wish to feel a connection. And that's understandable. But if we move back in time to, say, the Viking Age, people had no choice but to live in harmony with nature. And they faced a different challenge. It was not for lack of connection, but the fact that nature is not always harmony. Nature could be dangerous, destructive, and deadly. Nature was alive, yes. Nature was crammed with consciousnesses, different consciousnesses, different beings with their own needs and wishes. Those lovely, splashing little maidens, the waves, often called maidens in Norse poetry, they could easily turn into monstrous giantesses who were hungry for the company of helpless sailors. And then, only the cunning, only the best of Fjǫlkyngi's folk who knew how to speak to the wave goddesses or the wave giantesses, and the mercy of benevolent sky maidens could save a man. Welcome to part 4.3 of my 2021 Patreon lecture series Fjǫlkyngi, Stories of Seidr and Initiation. This is episode 4, Practical Seidr. In episode 4.1, Practical Seidr, we talked about summoning the game. And in episode 4.2, Practical Seidr, we talked about healing spells. And in this one, part 4.3, we are going to talk about controlling the weather and fire. And let us begin by introducing some of the Mottugar, the powers that rule the weather according to the mythology that has been left to us. The eagle corpse swallower. Now, the winds derive, according to the Edda poem Vafthrudnismål and Snorri Sturluson,
from the flapping of the wings of a giant in eagle's hide. A giant in eagle hide who sits by the end of heaven and whose name is Ræsvelgr. And Ræsvelgr, that means the corpse swallower. Nice. So let me read from Gylfaginning, chapter 18, Snorra Edda. Om upprona vinsins. Då mälte Gangleri. Vadan kemer vinder. Han stärker, svå att han rär I stor höf. Och han äser eld. En svå stärker som han Då må eige sjå han. Tvi han underliga skapader. In English, chapter 18, about the origin of the wind. Then spoke wandering Lerner, from where comes the wind? He is so strong that he rules the great seas and whips up fire, but strong as he is, he cannot be seen. Thus he is wondrously made. Då mälte hår, dat kan ek vel segja der, og nordanverdum himins enda, sitter jøtun så, Ræsvelgr heiter, han hefir arnar ham, en han beiner flug, då standa vindar undan vangum hans, her seger svå. English. Then spoke the high one. This I can well tell you. To the northernmost end of heaven, a jötun, a giant, sits, and he is called Corpse Swallower. He wears an eagle hide, and when he starts to fly, then winds stand out from beneath his wings. It is said so. Ræsvelgr heiter, sitter og himins enda, jötun I arnar ham. Af hans vangum kveda vind koma, alla men yfir. He is called Corpse Swallower, who sits at the end of heaven, a giant in eagle's hide. From his wings speak the winds coming over all men. Now, the Corpse Swallower is a mythical being that I have often compared with other giants in eagle hide, which appear in the myths. In the Skaldic poem Haustlöng, which dates back to the 9th century AD, we meet another giant in eagle's hide by the name of Jötun, who abducts the goddess Idunn. Yeah, I did hold a 6-hour, 3-part lecture about this theme, so you can look at that if you want to know a lot more. But for now, suffice it to say that Chasi, the giant in eagle's hide in the Skaldic poem Haustlöng, he is the father of the giantess Skadi, and he is called by many Heiti and Kenningar, that would be nicknames and metaphors, which suggest a theme of death and mortality, as I elaborated in my lecture series about Idunn. Chasi also flaps his wings and creates winds. And the winds are called Arnsug, which means eagle suction. So eagle suction is the same as wind. And he creates wind by eagle suction when he tries to kill Loki. In Snorri's Gylfaginning, we also hear of a giant in eagle's hide who sits at the top of the ash Yggdrasil, the universe tree. And between his eyes sits a falcon whose name is Veðurfölnir, the wind diminisher. As I have discussed many times before, the wind as a poetical symbol usually represents death and mortality, such as when Odin sacrifices himself to himself on the wind-swept tree, having an initiatory death experience in order to gain access to the runes of fate, the mead of poetry, and the 9 powerful galdrar, the spell songs. The winds of the giant eagle may thus refer to something else and more abstractly profound than just weather. But the sources we have about the wind-generating eagle should still be counted among the sources which describe the powers of weather. After all, There might be a reason why wind is poetically associated to death. Uncontrollable winds cause storms, and storms, the people knew that very well back then, storms caused shipwrecks and drownings and other mortal disasters. So it was of utmost importance to call on the powers that might help against them. The vanir and the weather. A power that may have been invoked in order to prevent harmful storms at sea could have been the god Njörður. In Gylfaginning, Snorra Edda, the prose Edda, Snorri claimed, chapter 23, Frå Nirdi og Skada, In Thridi Ås så, kallader Njörður. Han byr og himni, der sem heiter Noatun. Han rædir fyrir göngu vinds, og stiller sjå og eld. Og han skal heita til Sæfara og til Veida. And this means, in English, chapter 23 about Njörður and Skadi. And I'm not going to read the Skadi part here, just the part about Njörður being a ruler of winds and so on. The third god is the one who is called Njörður. He lives in that heaven, which is called Ship's Harbour. He rules over the path of the winds and controls sea and fire. To him, one should pray for seafaring and for fishing and hunting. Another Vanir god who may have been sought for weather control could have been Njörð's son, Freyr, who, according to the Gylfaginning, ruled the realm of rain and sunshine and the growth of the earth. Chapter 24. Frå Frey og Freyju. Njörður I Noatunum gat sidan två börn, het annat Freyr en dotter Freya. Thou vore föger ålitum och måttug. Freyr in ågätasti af åsum. Han räder fyre regni och skini solar och där med åväxti jardar. Och å han gott att heita till års och fridar. Han räder och fesälumanna. English, chapter 24, about Freyr and Freya. Njörður of Ship's Harbour begat afterwards two children. The son was called Freyr and the daughter Freya. They were all beautiful and powerful. Freyr is the most glorious of all the gods. He rules over the rain and the sunshine, and of the earth's yearly growth, and he is good to pray to for a good year and peace. He also rules over the wealth of men. Another obvious weathermaker is Thor, the thunder god. As we shall see in this episode, he could not only be invoked in order to make a whale strand on a beach, as happened in the story of Thorhall Veidimadr, which I told in part 4.1 about summoning the game. He could also be invoked by poetical means in order to make a storm and cause a shipwreck. We will return to that towards the end of this episode. Giantesses and the waves. The diverse waves of the ocean were personified as the nine daughters of the ocean giantess Rom, whose name means robbery. She was thought to receive the drowned, or perhaps thought to rob people of their lives at sea, since her name was Robbery. The souls of the drowned who dwell in her submarine realm are feasting and making love to Rom or her nine daughters. As pleasant as that realm might have been described, nobody really wanted to drown either. In the Edda poem Helga Kvida Jörvardsson, we meet a daughter of Rom, Hrimgerdr, whose name means frosty enclosure, a reference to drowning again, and she tries to drown a ship full of men and the prince Helgi. Now Helgi's cunning mentor, Atli, manages to keep the giantess occupied until the Valkyrjur arrive to save the day, their dazzling light turning the giantess into stone. I'm going to discuss this story very soon, But for now, let us count up the names of the giantesses, which are also the words for various kinds of ocean waves. These giantesses could take an interest in men and assault a ship in order to get new lovers. It is not entirely unlikely that people would have sacrificed to appease them. Here are some names listed by Snorri Sturluson in the Prose Edda. Blodughadda, bloody hair. Bylgja, billow, which is a word for wave. In modern Norwegian, we say bylge or bølge, and that means wave. Drøffen, comber, a kind of wave. Båra, which means foaming sea, another kind of wave. Dufa, yet another kind of wave. Hæfring, which means lifting, and is also a kind of wave that rises up. Himinglava, transparent on top, yet another wave. Hrønn, which means a sort of noisy wave. Kolga, which means a cool wave. And Udr or Unn, which means a little wave. Before we return to the poem where Atli saves his crew from the giantess of the ocean, we must of course turn to Odin, who may not be a god of the weather, but who, in capacity as a great Fjǫlkyngismaður, a man of great magical knowledge, and Seidmaður, a man who practices Seidr, had the ability to still storms and quiet the winds and the waves. Let me read from Ynglinga Saga 7, Fra Idrottum Odins, of Odins Sports. Odin could change his shape, or his hide. Then his body lay as if dead or sleeping, while he himself was beast or bird, fish or snake, and travelled in an instant to distant lands, on his own or on others' behalf. He could also do other things. With only words, he could quench a fire, silence the ocean, or turn the wind where he wanted. In the Edda poem Håvamål, Odin himself speaks of his ability that he can control the weather by singing magical songs. Håvamål, Sæmundar Edda. I know the seventh spell song. If I see a high flame surrounding the hall and those seated there, how broadly it burns, it can never be worse than that I can save them. Thus I can sing my galdr. I know the ninth spell song. If I am in need and must save my sinking boat, storm in the ocean, I can quiet down and make sleep in peace the entire sea. A similar theme is found in another Edda poem, the Seiðr Drífumál, where storms and shipwreck could be prevented with the use of magical runes. Seiðr Drífa says, ocean runes you must know if you want to keep safe the sea's sailing horses, that would be the ships. On the prow, the runes must be carved, and on the rudder, and burnt into ore with fire. However steep break the dark blue waves, you will come safe from the ocean. And this was spoken by a Valkyria, and we are going to return to the Valkyria now, very soon. Atli conquers Rímgerd, source Helgakvida Jörvardssonar, the poetic Edda. Atli appears in the poem of Helgi Jörvardsson as the son of Helgi's father's own earl. In the beginning of the poem, Atli goes into a sacred grove and sits out, utiseta, to hear the speech of the birds. Once the birds have given him a vision of a Valkyria who dwells in a different realm, a realm of dreams and sleep and souls, he goes through different trials in order to reach the supernatural woman on behalf of his king, Jörvardr. Atli, on behalf of his king, has to ascend a sacred mountain in order to look into that supernatural realm, and then he has to sleep next to a river in order to cross into that world. After slaying a giant in eagle's height, interesting, he manages to retrieve the Valkyria for his king and another supernatural maiden, a Valkyria, for himself too. Obviously, Atli is a Fjølkyngis mother, a Seid mother, perhaps, one who knows how to understand the speech of birds, various ritual forms, such as utiseta in a sacred grove, and the entering into other worlds by way of rivers and mountaintops. Later in life, Atli joins Jörvard's son, Helgi, Helgi Jörvardsson, on a quest for another Valkyria, one that Helgi has seen when he performed utiseta on a haugr, a burial mound. While they are out sailing the ocean in the night, Atli becomes aware of a dangerous giantess emerging from the depths of the sea. Her name is Hrimgerdr, and that means the frosty enclosure. And this is a reference to the drowning in the cold sea. She wants to have a piece of the men aboard the ships. But Atli keeps her occupied with his speech until the Valkyrier arrive to save the men from the hostile and dangerous giantess. I'm here going to read the entire passage and then discuss it later. I'm going to do this only in English to save time. Helgi and Atli lay their ship in the fjord of hatred. Atli kept watch during the first part of the night. Hrimgerdr, hatred's daughter, said, "Who are these men in the fjord of hatred? Their shields are hanging outside your ships. You are acting boldly. I do not think you fear much. Tell me the name of the king." Atli said, "His name is Helgi, and you may never bring harm to the prince. There are iron plates on the prince's ships. No giantesses may attack us." Hrimgerdr said, "What is your name, you mighty warrior? What do women call you? The king trusts you, since he lets you watch in the pleasant prow of the ship." Atli said, "My name is Atli, and I shall be mean to you. I am with giantesses most grim. By the dew-washed prow I have often stood and quenched the evening riders, the kveldridur," and that would mean the giantesses, or these women of the ocean waves. And Atli continues, "What is your name, you corpse-hungry ogress? Nagrathug hala. Name, you giantess, your father. 9 leagues you ought to be underground, with fur growing out of your bosom." So Atli thinks that she is ought to stay on the deep levels, not come there to harass them. Hrimgerdr said, "Hrimgerdr is my name. Hati, that is hatred, was my father. I knew him for the mightiest Jötun. Many brides he had taken from their men until Helgi killed him." Atli said, "You were ogress before the ships of the prince and blocked the mouth of the fjord. The king's men you would have given to Ron if a spear had not lodged in your flesh." So he, Atli, accuses the ogress of being the one who almost wrecked the ships of the king before, says that she would have given the men to Ram, as to the goddess of the drowned. Hrimgerdr said, "You are deluded now, Atli. I assume that you are dreaming. You are scowling with a drooping brow. It was my mother, Ron, who lay in front of the prince's ships. I drowned Ludvardsson in the ocean. So Rimgerd is basically saying that, no, you're crazy. That wasn't me. That was my mother, Ran. She was the one who lay in front of the prince's ships before, while I was drowning someone else. And it's also a very interesting reference to Atli dreaming while using some strange facial movements. I'm going to go back to that later. Rimgerd continues, "You would have neighed, Atli, if you had not been castrated. Geldurne værir." So Atli is castrated. Rimgerdir raises her tail. She's horny. "In your hindquarters, your heart, I think, Atli, dwells, though you have the voice of a stallion." Atli said, "Like a stallion, I would seem to you, if you wanted to try it. If I came on land from this ship, I would lame every part of you if I went fully into it. Ha, you would drop down your tail, Hrimgerdr, ogress." So basically, Hrimgerd is mocking him for not being able to have sex with her, while Atli is saying that if they had sex, he would have lamed every part of her and that she would not have been so horny anymore. But Hrimgerd replies, "Atli, come on land, if you trust your strength. Let us meet in the Bay of Varin. Your ribs straightened out, you would get, warrior, if you came into my grasps." So she would have crushed him, basically. So Rimgerd has challenged Atli, says, "Why not come on land and see if you can actually lay me?" Because she is quite sure that she can actually crush him. And she is the image of, she is the soul or the personality of an ocean wave. Let's move on. Atli said, well, he has to sort of accept her challenge, but he is, of course, trying to delay this. So he says, "I cannot go before the warriors wake up and they can keep watch for the king. I would not be surprised if you came close to the oars and bobbed up from under the ship," because she's a wave, right? Hrimgerdr said, "Wake up, Helgi, and give compensation to Hrimgerdr, since you cleave through hatred," her father. "One night I would sleep with the prince, then I would have compensation for my loss." So Hrimgerd wants a night of pleasure with Helgi, the prince that Atli is mentoring. And Helgi wakes up. And Helgi says, "The furry one is the name of the man who shall own you. Hideous you are to mankind. That monster, by the way, lives on the island of suffering, a very wise Jötun, but the worst of volcano dwellers. He would be fitting, he would be to you a fitting match." So Helgi is sort of suggesting that the wave finds a lover elsewhere, and he tries to sort of tell her where he is so that she might leave to find a more fitting match. But Rimgerdr said, "You would rather have her, Helgi, who was observing the harbour the other night with the men, the sea golden maiden, surpassing me in power. Here she landed from the ship and moored your vessel so. She alone rules that I cannot destroy and be the bane of the prince's men." So when Helgi tries to get her to look for another man to mate with, Rimgerd mentions the sea golden maiden, a Valkyria who was observing the harbour the other night. And Rimgerd knows that this maiden surpasses even herself in power. And that and she informs the men that this Valkyria is the only one who actually prevents her from destroying and being the bane, the death of the prince's men. And Helgi takes the opportunity to ask Rimgerd about something. Helgi said, "Here now, Rimgerd, if I was to compensate your grief, answer me directly. Was it just one spirit, a Vætr, who protected the noble ships, or were they many faring together?" And by spirit, he is referring to the Valkyria. And he asks whether there is just one Valkyria, one Vater, one spirit, or more traveling together. And Rimgerd replies, 3 times 9 maidens, the one rode before all, bright beneath her helmet, a maiden. The horses were trembling, from their manes stood, dew in the deep valleys, hail into the high woods. From there come good year growth to men. All of this was hateful to me that I watched. Atli said, Look to the east now, Rimgerd, for Helgi has struck you with the runes of Hel. On land and at sea, saved is the king's fleet, and so are the prince's men. It is day now, Hrimgerdr, and you have been occupied by Atli's conversation. As a harbour mark you seem to be quite ridiculous where you stand there in the likeness of a stone. What happened here then? Let us sum the story up. Young Helgi has embarked on a quest to find the Valkyria that he had earlier seen in a vision when he was meditating in a state of utiseta, sitting outside, on a haugur, a burial mound. Before him, his father, King Jörvardr, had sought the same thing, a mysterious Valkyria dwelling in a land of sleep and dreams and souls. Atli had helped King Jörvardr on his quest by entering a sacred grove to speak with birds, climbing the top of a sacred mountain to look into the Valkyria's realm, and then slept next to a river in order to enter that realm and retrieve the Valkyria for the king. While so doing, Atli obtained his very own Valkyria too. Now young Prince Helgi must find his Valkyria, and Atli appears as the experienced mentor. He guards the fleet of the prince and becomes aware of an ocean giantess, Hrimgerdr, Frosty Enclosure, and she threatens to sink the fleet by bobbing up beneath the ships. She would like to sacrifice the men to her mother, which is likely to be Ron, the goddess of the drowned. As such, Hrimgerdr is another name for one of the ocean giantess's daughters. Her name, Frosty Enclosure, suggests a threat of drowning. Ron and her daughters are fond of men. They want them for their lovers, which is why they attempt to drown men. In poetry, death by drowning is usually described as climbing the bed of Ron or similar. Hrimgerdr is no exception, and first she mocks Atli for being castrated. Otherwise, she would have been ready to have him sexually, in the sense that he would die by drowning. This point about castration is interesting, as there has been some other hints about some sort of gender atypical behaviour among male practitioners of Seidr. In this case, however, castration could also be metaphorical. Hrimgerdr would have had Atli for a lover, which means that she could have made him drown. But Atli is incapable of having sex with her in the sense that he is not capable of drowning, probably due to his great Fjǫlkyngi, his great magical knowledge. When she mocks him, Atli claims that he would have been as a stallion to her and make her lame, in the sense that he would have conquered her death by drowning. He would have mastered her, as in he would have mastered death and quenched the drowning wave that she represents. Hrimgerdr is willing to take the challenge, recognizing his bluff and asserting that Atli would have had his ribs stretched out by her clutch. Hrimgerdr makes a rather interesting observation, which could be taken as a hint to what Atli is really doing here. He is dreaming, she says, and scowling with a drooping brow as he speaks to her. I think this is a powerful hint towards an act of magical performance. Atli is in a trance state when speaking to the wave, And, like we have been seen described in other sources, he is making facial movements while speaking to the giantess in a state of trance. In part 4.1 of this lecture episode, Summoning the Game, we saw how Thor Halveidimadr made many sounds and facial movements while lying down as in a dream when he requested help from Thor to make a whale strand on the beach. Earlier, in episode 2 about oracular Seidr, we saw how the völva Heidr gaped much, wrenched her jaws open and drew her breath deeply before speaking out her chants of prophecy. I believe this is what is actually happening when Atli is communicating with the wave giantess in order to stop her from wrecking the ships. Rimgerdir, the wave, then demands a night of sex with Prince Helgi as a compensation for the murder of her father, Hati, whose name directly translates as hatred. This night of pleasure would, of course, mean Helgi's own death by drowning in a shipwreck during the night, and thus becoming the lover of the shipwrecking waves. Helgi wakes up and joins Atli in his chanting against the wave, telling her that she is hideous to men and that there is a better lover for her out there, and even suggestively names that lover. Perhaps he is hoping that she will move away in order to search for the man who is better suited for her needs. Hrimgerdir declares that Helgi is more interested in the Valkyria, a sea golden maiden who is more powerful than Hrimgerdir and who is the only thing that stops her from wrecking the ships. Just to point out that it was not really Atli who prevented disaster, but the help of another, more benevolent supernatural power, a Valkyria. Helgi, curious, makes use of this vision to ask the giantess a question, whether the Valkyria appeared alone or with many others. Hrimgerdir replies that the maiden was riding in the front of a group of 3x9 Valkyrier, and they were shining, and they were creating dew in the deep valleys and hail in the high forest. As if having invoked the aid of the Valkyrier, they appear, and Atli tells Hrimgerdir to look to the east, to the rising sun and the day, for Helgi has made Hel runes, death magic against her, while Atli kept her occupied, and now she will turn into the likeness of a stone and stand forever like a ridiculous harbour mark, and it is declared. Orlandi och Allegi. Borgit loftungsflåta och siklingsmonnum id sama. On land and at sea, saved is the king's fleet, and so are the prince's men. So, this is one of the few sources suggesting that the Valkyrier not only could be invoked to save men from shipwreck and storm by exerting greater power than the ocean giantesses, but that they could also have a role in the realm of weather. It finds a counterpart in another related Edda poem, the Helgakvida Hunningsbani. Here, Helgi Jörvardsson has been reincarnated as Helgi, the son of Sigmundur Völsung. I mentioned Sigmund Völsung in the previous episode about healing, where Sigmundur saved his son or nephew, Sinfjötli, from a fatal wound by receiving a herb from a raven after observing how two weasels used the herb for healing. They were both in the shapes of wolves when this happened. Helgi Hunningsbani is Sinfjötli's younger half-brother, and here Sinfjötli has taken the same magical mentor role for Helgi Hunningsbani as Atli had for his previous life alter ego, Helgi Jörvardsson. In the second poem of Helgi Hunningsbani, we read: Helgi samnade då Miklom skap skipa här och for till Frekasteins og Fengo i Hafi, Åfvidr i Mandhett. Da kvåmu leipter yfyrdå, og stodo geislar i skipin. Der sa i Luptino at valkyrior nio rido, og kendo der Sigruno. Da lægde stormin, og kvåmu der heiler til lands. In English, Helgi assembled a great ship army and went to Frekastein, and on the ocean ran into a terribly dangerous storm. Lightning flashed above them, and their ships were struck. They saw 9 valkyrier ride in the air and recognized Sigrun among them. Then the storm abated, and they got safely to land. The first poem of Helgi Hunningsbani contains several descriptions of valkyrier saving men from ocean storms, and also of valkyrier who have some influence on weather phenomena. Let me read. Then a light shone from the mountain of flames, and from that radiance came lightning. Then valkyrier were beneath helmets in the fields of heaven. Their armors were drenched with blood, and from their spears rays of light stood out. Then it was to be heard that together they came, Kolga's sister. Kolga is a name of the ocean, one of the ocean waves kinds, and her sister is another kind of ocean wave. So these are the waves coming. I begin again. Then it was to be heard that together they came, Kolga's sister and the longships. So these clashed together, the waves and the longships, as a mountain of surf wave might break the ships. Helgi bid that they set the high sail over. From the play of battle the crew did not cringe, when the unruly daughter of Egir, that is the ocean wave, the ocean mares, the ships, wanted to wreck. Then Sigrun herself came from above. She protected the crew and their vessels. She twisted powerfully out of Rón's grasp the king's sea beasts by the grove of Gnipa. Basically, the Valkyria Sigrun came and saved the ships from being wrecked by Rón. A storm there was then as they clashed together, pale spear points at Freka stone. Was ever Helgi, Hunning's bane, foremost in the army where men were fighting, eager in battle, averse to flight, the prince had a hard acorn of a heart. Then came from the heaven the helmet bright ones. From above the noise of spears resounded. The valkyrie protected the prince. Then said Sigrun, as the wound wise ones flew, that the ogress's steed ate of Hugin's meal. Now this was had so many metaphors that I'll just say that the helmet bright ones are the valkyrier, and Sigrun is Helgi's valkyria. The wound wise ones are also the valkyrier. The ogress's steed is the wolf, which is, it could be a symbol of death. So death ate the slain, Hugin's meal. Hugin is Odin's raven. This Edda heroic poetry is, I think, the only sources we have where valkyrier clearly both influence the weather in some way by emitting rays of light, and also intervene when seamen are facing the onslaughts of the drowning giantesses. So the valkyrier are saving the ships as they appear in the sky like the sun goddess dispersing the thunderous skies. However, these texts are quite detailed, and there are in fact a lot of verses describing the valkyrier in this way. We hardly have more sources to any of the other gods and goddesses when it comes to determining their spheres of power either. One single piece about Freya enjoying love poetry has been widely accepted as clear evidence for her role as a goddess of love, despite there being many other and more sources describing Freya as, say, a völva, one who gives the traveler a bird hide when he travels into other worlds, and a receiver of the dead, and a guide to Valhalla. We have a lot more about that yet. This one half sentence suggesting that she liked love poetry and was good to pray for in things that had to do with love, she, among many others, has given her the role as goddess of love. And we saw described in the, we have seen how Freyr, Odin, and Thor, and Njord, and all these gods have been associated to weather, to being powers of weather, because we have some sentences saying that they were, but none of them actually had so many verses describing in detail how they actually intervene in terms of weather as we have about the Valkyrie. So likewise, the Valkyrie's role as a server of mead in Valhalla and her role in choosing the slain to be taken there has no more source material to back that well-established function than we have sources about the Valkyrie rescuing men from shipwreck by appearing in the skies with rays of lightning causing dew and hail. Based on the amounts of sources we do have, compared to how we accept very scarce source material to define other deities and powers, we must assume that this Valkyria function of weather influencers, creators of hail, causers of dew, and emitting rays of lightning and just light, we must assume that this function was just as important as any of the other functions that they are more famous for today. Another aspect of the Valkyrie is the fact that Edda poetry describes them as being attached in loving relationships to the men who have sought them and won them through various trials and even from lifetime to lifetime. Also, in these poems, the Valkyrie function in a very similar way as the spirit helpers and spirit spouses known from shamanistic and animistic traditions elsewhere. The waves are animistically seen as potentially hostile spirits wanting to lure sailors to their deaths. Death by drowning is poetically seen as an act of sexual intercourse with the giantess waves, something humans did not really want, even if the horny giantesses could care less about what we want. Attempts to make the giantesses turn their attention to more suitable lovers are made. Likewise, attempts to let the wave women know that their chosen lovers are in fact unwilling. And this could be a way of trying to ward off these dangerous waves, these giantesses, by telling them that, look, we're not happening. Like helping spirits, the Valkyrie are called upon to help combat hostile spirits, and since they are powers that influence the weather, they can also conquer the giant spirited waves of the ocean, hungry for fresh corpses to feast with. In the embrace and love of the Valkyrie, men find a better fate than that and a better death. Shrouding the place with fog. Source, Hrolf's saga Kroka. So let us return to a saga part that I already mentioned in episode 2 of my Fjǫlkyngi series, the episode about oracular Seidr. I am referring to the first 3 chapters of the saga of Hrolf Kroki, where a king called Frodi is trying to get his 2 young nephews killed. The boys go into hiding, and the king employs both Völur and Visendamen, as in wise men, and Galdramen too, in his effort to find the boys. The 2 young princes find support in an old, wise, and clairvoyant man who is Forvitra, a man of profound learning. You may remember, if you saw the Idunn lecture, that Idunn is called Dis Forvitin, a knowledge-hungry goddess. So this is used for people who are of profound learning, who have been hungry for knowledge. So this Visendamadr, this wise man, is called Vifil, and he manages to hide the boys by way of causing a thick fog to surround them. I read. Chapter 1. Then Frodi sought the aid of Völur and Visendamen, wise knowing people, in all parts of the land. He had them search the country up and down, even the islands and the outlying rocks. They found nothing. Now, the king sought out Galdramen, that would be people who could perform spell songs, men, apparently, who could pry into anything they wished. They told him the boys were not being brought up on land, yet they were not far from the king. Search there first, said the Galdramen, because a great mist and secrecy, Mikil Thoka og Hulda, surround that east island. Only with difficulty can we see the area around this man's house. He seems to be a person of profound learning, ver han får vitra. And there is more to him than meets the eye. Chapter 2. Early one morning, Vifil awoke with a sense of foreboding. Of course, he was clairvoyant. He said to the boys, "The air and the paths are alive with magic. And mighty Fylgjur, followers, and Mottugar, powers, have arrived on the island." So fortunately for the boys, the wise old man, Vifil, who lives on the island where they are hiding, has managed to shroud the place with magical fog. But now he can sense the presence of the spirits applied by the other sorcerers in their search for the boys. Spirits, or to quote the actual text, Fylgjur og Mottugar, followers and powers. These spirit beings have been sent out by the Völur, the Visendamen, and the Galdramen that the evil King Frodi has employed, and Vifil, being a wise man himself, can sense their presence, their spirits or spirit helpers in the form of Fylgjur and other Mottugar powers, searching the island for the hidden boys. Thus, Vifil, through his clairvoyance, can warn the boys and now tells them that they need to hide in the woods and then find a better place to hide. Galdrar och gärningar. Øyvind Kelda creates darkness and fog with Fjǫlkyngi, but is countered with Christian Seidvilla. Sources: Heimskringla, Snorra Sturlusonar, Olafs Saga Tryggvasonar, 69 and 70. Flatøyarbok, Olafs Saga Tryggvason, 44. So let's take Snorri's Olafs Saga Tryggvasonar, chapter 69. Seidmanna brenna, the burning of the Seidmen. Olafur king went to Tunsberg, and there he held parliament, Ottidardo en thing. And he spoke there at the parliament and said that any man who made himself guilty of faring with spell songs and witchcraft, that would be galdrar och gärningar, or who were sidemen, they should all leave the country. After this, the king let search the country for such people around in the regions close by, and bid them all present themselves before him. The men came there, and among them was a man who was called Eivindr Kelda. Kelda means cauldron. He was the son of Rangvaldr Rettilbeini, the son of Haraldr Hårfagri. Eivindr was a seidmadr, and utterly versed in great magical knowledge. He was Allmjøk Fjølkunniger. Olafur king let these men sit inside a hall. He let them have good treatment, made a banquet for them, and let them have a lot of strong drink. and when they were drunk, Olafur let put fire to the hall, and the hall burned, so that all the people who were inside there burned up, except for Eivindr Kelda, who came out of the fire pipe and got away. And when he had come far away, he met some people on the road who thought to visit the king. He asked them to tell the king this, that Eivindr Kelda had gotten away from the fire, and that he would never again come into Olafur king's power, and that he would continue as before with all his arts, his kunnustusina, his arts. And when these men came to find Olafur king, they told him all that Eivindr had asked them to tell. The king lamented the fact that Eivindr was not dead. Chapter 70. Drop Eivindr Keldu. The death of Eivindr Kelda. Olafur king went, when spring approached, out west into Viking region, and took residence in his great settlements there, and sent messengers to all the people of Viking that he would have an army out in the summer and go north in the country. After that, he went north to Agder, when there was a long fast. He went north to Rogaland and came on Easter Eve, Påskeaften, to Kørmt at Avaldsnes. There was prepared a great Easter banquet, and he had near 300 men. So a Christian celebration was going to take place at Avaldsnes beneath the king Olafur Tryggvason, who was the second king who tried, without success, to christen Norway. He's not to be mistaken with the third king who tried to christen Norway and who was sort of successful, even if the christening happened after his death. That would be Olaf the Holy. This is the other Olaf coming before him. During that night came Eivindr Kelda there. He had a fully crewed longship. They were all Seidmen and other Fjølkyngis folk, people of great magical knowledge. Eivindr went ashore with all his men and Mögnudu Fjølkyngisina started to empower their great magical knowledge. Eivind made his men be covered by a Hulidsjalm, a helmet of invisibility, and a Thokumyrkir, darkness of fog, so great that the king and his army could not see anything. So basically, Eivindr Kelda and his men were trying to blind the men of Olaf Tryggvason by making themselves invisible and covering the place in a darkness of fog through their great magical knowledge, their Fjǫlkyngi. But when they came up to the farm at Avaldsnes, there was made bright day, and then it went a very different way than what Eivindr had planned. That darkness, which han hafti gert med Fjølkyngi, that he had made with great magical knowledge, fell over himself and his own men, so that they could not see more with their own eyes than with their necks, and they started to move in circles around. One of the king's guardsmen saw where they were, and they could not understand what sort of people these were. The king was alerted, and he and his men got up from bed and dressed themselves. When the king saw Eivindr Kelda and his people walk about there, he told his men that they should take their weapons and go and find out what these were for people. The king's men recognized Eivindr, and so they captured him and all the others and led them to the king. Then Eivindr had to tell how all this had happened. Afterwards, the king let all of them be taken and put out on a reef in the ocean, which would be submerged with the flow, and let them be tied up there. Thus, Eivindr and all his men lost their lives, and this reef has later been called Skrattasker, the reef of the sorcerers. So, what happened here? Eivindr and his men, who were all Seidmen, Galdramen, or other kinds of Fjølkunniga Visendamen, applied their great magical knowledge, their Fjǫlkyngi, in order to create darkness and fog to confuse and blind the king and his men. But in this saga, the Christian king is protected by Christian Seidvilla, a counter magic that could confuse and turn the Seidr around. So the dark fog turns against its creators and leaves them blind and vulnerable to their enemies instead. The same story is referred to in one of the other sagas of Olaf Tryggvason, the one found in Flatøyarbok, chapter 44, Frå Olaf I Konungi og Eivindi Keldu, about Olaf King and Eivindir Kelda. I read, the event took place on the same night that the king and the bishop were there, and mass took place. Then a man named Eivindir Kelda came to the headland, the same man who came out of the fire when the Seidmen were burned. He, Eivindir, now had 5 ships and had come from the sea and was now moored near the town of Avaldsnes. He now thought he had a great deal of confidence where his army was, and yet most of all, who were very knowledgeable men, fjølkunniger men. For there were many in his company, but yet he knew most of them. And now he intends to go to the king Olaf and kill him with all his army. But now it came to pass here, as the psalmists say, that his wickedness rose over his head, and in the snare which he himself had eyed, he and himself were caught. I have mentioned before that the reputation for ergi, that are supposedly meant to be common to male practitioners of Seidr, may not be entirely correct. Do not misunderstand, please. It is very possible that there were some sort of gender transitioning aspects of Seidr, but archaeological finds have suggested that when this is the case, this was honoured rather than despised, at least within the context of magic. And there really is actually very little in the sources to base the common assumption that sidemen were considered shameful in any sexual or gender-like way, or in any other way. You really only have a statement from the 13th century. The actual stories of male practitioners show that they could be anything, that they were often seen as wise and powerful and mysterious, that they often had a place of the at the courts of powerful men, and that they may have played an important part in the fight against the Christian conversion kings, whether they were gender-conforming or not. This resistance alone could have led to the accusation of ergi as a way of slandering the opposition, or emphasizing something that people previously had sort of accepted, but now made to think that, whoa, look at listen, this is, they are not manly, and things like that. But in this context, what is interesting here is the notion that the weather could be controlled through Seidr or Fjølkyngi. And this story also shows how two enemies could perform Seidr and counter Seidr against each other. The conversion to Christianity did not mean that people stopped believing in magic. Many are the stories which show that the Christian side counter pagan magic with magic of their own. The morale of the story was probably to show that the Christian faith in itself was more powerful than all the great magical knowledge of the opposing pagan side. To us, the story serves to tell us something about the belief people had in some people being able to control some aspects of the weather, causing fog or darkness or light through the art of Fjølkyngi. A family creates a storm by Seidr. Source, Laxdala Saga, chapter 35, 36 and 37. In the Laxdala Saga, chapter 35, we hear of a whole family of Fjølkyngiga folks. The man is called Kotkel, the wife Grima, and the two have 2 sons, Halbjørn Whetstone Eye and Stigandi. The saga reads, Øl våre mjøk fjølkunniga og ener mestu seidmenn. They were all very fjølkunniga and the greatest of seidmenn. Here, the word men refers to a group of people, in this case the family, and not necessarily to male humans, because it included Grima, the wife. For some reason, the family was hostile towards a woman called Ingunn and kept harassing her. Ingunn's son, Thord, went to the family and tried to threaten them for harassing his mother. Rather than complying, the family went into attacking mode. They were quite vicious. And I read, Then Kotkell made rise a seidjallr, which is an elevated seed made for seances of Seidr, which we saw many references to in episode 2 about oracular seid. So here they rise a seidjallr and they, the whole family of four, all went to sit on it. And then they sang hard, twisted songs. They were galdrar, spell songs. And soon, with these galdrar, they had made rise a mighty storm. Thord, Ingunn's son, and his travelling companions soon understood that the storm was directed against them. Galdrar och gärningar, a storm of unpeace. Source, Fritjof's saga hins Frækna, chapter 5-7. So, in the saga of Fritjof the Bold, an enemy hires two fjölkunniga konur, two women of great magical knowledge, who employ seidr in the form of galdrar och gärningar, spell songs and deeds, or witchcraft deeds. I read chapter 5. After that, they bought from fjölkunnigum konum, women of great magical knowledge, who were called Heidr and Hamglama, that they should make dangerous weather against Frithjof and his men, so that they may all perish at sea. The women now spent all their powers on the Seidr and went to sit on the Jallr, and that would be the Seidjallr, the elevated seat for seances of Seidr. So they went to sit on the Jallr with galdrar och gärningar, spell songs and deeds. Now that the men had come away from land, then the sea became unrestful, and there was a mighty storm. When Frithjof and his crew came out of Sogn, there was a harsh weather, and a strong storm came over them. The sea became very high and big, and the ship got up to great speed, since it was a fast runner and an excellent steed. Then sang Frithjof this verse. I from Sogn let swim, the famous steed of the waves, the ship. In the middle of Balder's garden, the sea, the maiden sat with sorrow. Terribly the ocean foams. May the maidens have great joy, they who wished us well, even if Elidi sinks. So Elidi is the ship's personal name, and the maidens are the maidens of the ocean, the waves. So he wishes the maidens great joy. So maybe he's trying to placate them here. I read on. Björn said, It would be a good thing if you now had other things to do than to sing about the maidens of Baldur's garden, because that would be a glorious death. The maidens of the ocean are Ran and her 9 daughters who received the drowned. So Björn objects to Frithjof sort of invoking the attention of these maidens, because their presence usually means death by drowning and shipwreck. But Frithjof says the storm will not get smaller. They were driven north to the sounds close to those islands called sun groves, and then the weather was at its harshest. And when they came far out from land, then the sea went harsh yet again. And there was a storm with powerful snowfall that one could not see from one side of the ship to the other, and the sea struck above the ship so that they had to pour out the water. Then said Frithjof, No land may we see. We have reached the surfs, brave lads of the army. We stand now against a bewitched storm. The sun groves are gone. 18 men must pour, protected by Elidi. So Fritjof sort of understands that the storm is bewitched. It's a magical storm. Have to jump up past some things here, but then came such a powerful wave that it tore off parts of the ship and threw 4 men overboard, and all of them drowned. Fritjof said, "Oh no, now 4 of us law-abiding men have fared, they who owe their lives." And Rån heard the brave boys, that impolite woman, that ran, towards her seats and bed. So he says that the Rån, the ocean giantess, is herding these brave men toward her seats and bed, and she's really being impolite, actually. Now it seems to me that we may expect, said Fritjof, that some of our men will fare to Rome. We will not seem prepared for such a voyage when we arrive there, unless we prepare ourselves swiftly. It seems to me that every man must carry some gold. And this is so as not to arrive poor at Rån's hall. He wants to prepare the men for death by drowning and to have some gold so that they can appear to be rich men when they enter Rån's hall. So he's thinking about their afterlife here. And Fritjof cut off the arm ring that Ingeborg, that was his girlfriend, had given to him, and cut the ring into pieces, which he shared out among his men, and said this verse: "The red ring, once owned by Halfdan's rich father, shall now be cloven before Egir, the red one, the abundant one, embraces us." So this is the ocean embracing them. He is expecting to drown now. "Gold shall be seen on us guests if we are to visit the halls of Rån. This gold will look good on the quick fighters." So he's sort of comforting his men, saying that, yeah, it looks like we're going to drown now, but at least we're going to look good when we enter Rån's hall. We're going to wear gold and stuff. Then said Björn, "It is not that certain, and we do not yet give up all hope." Both Fritjof and the others now saw that the ship was moving fast ahead, but they knew not where they were going. Since there was such darkness on all sides of them, combined with crashing waves, storm, frost, snow, and intense cold, and they could not see from one part of the ship to the other. So all this is being caused by the magic of the two Fjølkyngiga konur, the Hamglam and Heidr. Then Fritjof went up high and said to his brothers when he came down again, "I saw a very strange sight, since a huge whale has laid itself around the ship, and I am of a mind that we must be very close to some land, and that the whale is trying to keep us from embarking. I am certainly thinking that Helgi King is not preparing anything benevolent for us, for I see 2 women on the back of the whale. And they are certainly conjuring this enemy storm with their worst Seidr and Galdr. Now we shall see a proof of whether our gifts is stronger than their witchcraft, trolldom. And we shall stare right against them, and I shall strike them." So Fritjof has finally identified who caused the way this storm. There are 2 trollkoner, 2 women appearing on the back of a whale that is preventing them and moving the ship away from the shore and preventing them from embarking at ashore. And Fritjof, being the poet, starts to compose more poetry while almost drowning. "I see troll women, trollkoner, 2 on the wave. They have been sent here by Helgi. We shall cut them through in the middle, with Elidi's, the ship's, back, soaring fast." It has been told that the ship, Elidi, had this quality that it understood the speech of men. Then, said Björn, "Now we could see how honest these brothers have been with us." And Björn leapt to the stair, but Fritjof clasped a harpoon and leapt up to the prow and said this verse: Hail to you, Elidi! Run you on the wave! Break through the troll woman's teeth and forehead, cheeks and jaws, foot or both feet, into the nasty troll witch. Thereafter, he shot the harpoon against one of the hamhleipur, that means hide runners, and it means the two women who are in another hide. They're outside of their bodies, basically, riding the back of a whale, but they can still be hurt by the harpoon he shoots at them. So he shoots this harpoon against one of them, while Elidi's prow hit the other one's back. So one is spared and the other is hurt by the prow of the ship. And so both their backs were broken, but the whale submerged and swam away, and they never saw it again. Then the weather began to get milder. Thorgerdr Hölga Brudr, Thorgerd Håloga Bride. Sources: Jums Vikingasaga, Njåls Saga, Thorleifs Thotter Jarlaskalds, Skaldskaparmål, Færøyingasaga, Hardarsaga og Holmverja, and Ketils Saga Hanks. Let us begin with the first source, Jums Vikingasaga 21. This is the source that is the most relevant to this one, because it's about the weather. So Jums Vikingasaga chapter 21. So Håkon Sigurdarson, also known as Håkon Jarl in Riki, which means Earl Håkon the Powerful, was a historical person who lived in Norway between something around 937 until about 995 AD. So he died 35 years before the final Christianization of Norway. And he was in firm opposition to the emergence of the new Christian religion. He was also known to be a particularly devoted man, devoted to a supernatural female entity, a giantess, goddess or other sort of these, namely Thorgerd Håloga Bride. The Håloga Bride is a reference to the ancient kingdom of Hålogaland in northern Norway, which until quite recently had been one of Norway's most powerful nations, before Norway became one nation. Thorgerd may have been a fylgja, a follower spirit, particularly attached to the descendants of the rulers of Hålogaland, perhaps an ættarfylgja, a following spirit that follows a particular ættir, a clan or a family lineage. In chapter 21 of the Jomsvikingasaga, there is a great battle, and Håkon feels that he is about to lose. He goes to an island where it is said that he falls to his knees, and while looking northwards, he prays to Fulltruasin, his full troth. That would be the Norse word for a patron deity. If there is a favorite deity or other form of power that someone is particularly devoted to, that deity or other power would be called a fulltrui, his full troth. So he asks to Thorgerd, who is his fulltrui, for victory. And his patron goddess, a giantess, is here referred to as Thorgerdr Hørdatrøll, the troll of the Hårleger, or the people from Hordaland. So she had many names, and this is probably a way for the saga chronicler to denounce her. We have so many sources about this giantess that she was probably a lot more important than most textbooks about important goddesses in Norse mythology are. She suggests, they don't suggest enough. She is really, really quite important here, and the chroniclers wanted to portray her in a very negative light, of course. According to the saga, Þorgerðr repeatedly refuses Håkon's offerings for victory, but finally accepts the blot, the sacrifice, of his 7-year-old son. After sacrificing the prince, Earl Håkon returns to his fleet and presses his men to engage in an attack, reassuring them that victory was certain, for he had now invoked for victory both the sisters, Þorgerðr and Irpa. And he boasts, Tví at nu hefi ek heiti til sigers oss, og der syster båðar, Þorgerði og Irpu, og munu der eigi bregdast mer, nu helder en fyr. For now I have invoked for victory both the sisters, Þorgerðr and Irpa, and now they will favor us better than before. Håkon enters his ship. The fleet rows forward for the attack, and battle ensues. The weather becomes thick in the north, the clouds cover the sky, daylight becomes sparse, thunder and lightning ring out, and it begins to rain. The enemy fleet fights facing the storm and the cold, and they have trouble standing due to the heavy wind. The enemy throw weapons, missiles and stones at Håkon's fleet, but the winds turn their projectiles back at them. Then one of the men, Håvard, was able to see the supernatural woman standing at the prow, and then many men see her too. As the wind wanes, men witness arrows flying out of Þorgerðr's fingertips, killing the Jomsvikings, realize that they are no longer fighting only men, as in humans, but are still willing to do their best. The fighting continues into the dark hours, and now they could see two women doing what Þorgerðr had done before. Her sister, Irpa, had joined her, and they were both hurling every sort of missile back towards the enemies of Håkon. Soon enough, the women even caused large hailstones to fall from the sky against the enemy. The enemy's leader finally decides to retreat and explains his decision. The Jomsvikings had made vows to fight their enemy, but they had expected their enemy to be mortal men of equal standing. Neither he nor his men had ever vowed to fight against the worst of trolls, verstu troll, as in something sinister and powerful that is not human and besides rather hostile, and that you just cannot fight. Njål's Saga, chapter 88. Þorgerðr and Irpa are again mentioned together in chapter 88 of Njål's Saga, where a certain Hrap breaks into a temple run by Håkon Earl. Here, Hrap sees a seated depiction of Þorgerðr and takes a large gold ring from her, as well as a linen hood that she is wearing. He also sees a depiction of the god Thor and steals a gold ring from that god as well. Not content with his temple plundering, he even takes the ring that belongs to a statue of Irpa. Then he takes all the god statues out of the temple, Thor, Þorgerðr and Irpa, strips them of every item and burns the pagan temple. Such acts are often described in the saga sources, where the favored hero of the story is depicted either as a good Christian or else as a really bad pagan who has no respect for the gods of his own religion. This way of telling a story may have been a way of denouncing the previous religion. Destroying the pagan temple was applauded. But it could of course also have happened during the long and painful century of conversion. Whatever really happened, such stories serve to tell us something of what people who lived just after the conversion might have still known about the religious customs of their grandparents. The story tells us that there was a temple with wooden god statues, one of the god Thor, another of Þorgerðr Hålogabride bride, and one of her sister Irpa. All three statues wore golden rings and clothing and other items. Þorgerðr is mentioned in the Skaldskaparmál, Here, Hålogaland is described as named after King Hölgi, and he was Torgerd's father and husband. According to Skaldskaparmál, blot were made to both Torgerd and her father, mostly about wealth, and that gifts of gold and silver, earth and stone, were given to Hölgi. Hölgabrúðr, Hålogabride, is also mentioned in Snorri's lists of mythical names under the category Trollkvenna, trollwomen, alongside many known and lesser-known giantesses and river names, such as Gríðr, Gríla, Gjálp, Hyrokin, Hrímgerd, Imd, Jarnsaxa, Mörn, Ívidja, Símul, Jarnvidja, Myrkrida. In chapter 23 of Færøyinga saga, Earl Håkon recommends putting one's trust in Thorgerd and suggests that another man comes with him to her temple to ask for fortune. They arrive at a house with a stake fence around it, a beautiful house with carvings inlaid with gold and silver. It is lit from glass windows in the ceiling, so that the daylight illuminates the room in a way that allows for no shadows. Inside there were depictions of many gods, and especially a well-dressed woman by the entrance. Håkon threw himself to the ground before the woman statue and put an offering of silver in front of her image. In chapter 19 of the saga Hardar saga og Holmverja, Grímkell Bjarnarsson, a Godi, a pagan priest, closely related to Håkon, goes to the Hof, the temple of Thorgerd, and asks for a successful marriage for his daughter. The giantess in the temple replies that Grímkell is soon to die. Grímkell is so disappointed and so upset that he burns down the temple, and a few hours later, Grímkell suddenly falls dead. In chapter 5 of Ketil's saga Hengs, Ketil encounters a troll woman in the forest. The troll woman tells him that she is traveling to a trollathing, a parliament of trolls. Among the major figures who will be present, she continues to say, is Thorgerd Hörga troll. In Thorleifs Totter Jarlaskalds, in chapter 173 of Olaf's saga Tryggvasonar, in the Flateyjarbok, one Thorleifr Åsgeirsson, known as Jarlaskald, the Earl's Skull, recites an abusive and magically aggressive poem in Earl Håkon's hall, and Håkon is injured. Håkon recovers from his injuries and offers gifts to Thorgerd and Irpa, seeking their counsel on how best to take vengeance on Thorleif. Following the advice of the giantess sisters, Håkon has a wooden man, in Old Norse, tremaður, built out of driftwood, and he endows it with a human heart. Håkon and the two sisters, Thorgerd and Irpa, then bring the tremaður to life, arm him with a halberd, and send him to Iceland to kill Thorleifr, which he does. So this is probably one of the more voodoo-like stories that we have in Norse sources. It's not the only one. So, to conclude, Thorgerdr was evidently a sort of giantess or fylgja, or goddess, that held significant power over anyone attached to Håkon Earl and his lineage. She had a temple which she shared with other gods, but was herself the focal point of that temple. Her devotees believed very actively in her power and could invoke her for making storms in the ocean, hailstorms, protecting against enemy missiles, like a valkyria to her friends and like a troll to her enemies. Evidently, she can also help in creating life in a wooden figure and tell people when they're going to die, and also for other requests. So she had a very wide function. Steinunn Refsdottir, a female skald at the age of conversion. Sources: Njål's saga, chapter 101-102, Kristni saga 9, and Landnomabok 27. So, Steinunn Skall was an Icelandic woman and a devoted pagan who came from a powerful family of godar, as in pagan priests. She was the daughter of Refr the Great, and she was mother to a famous skald, Hofgarda Refr Gestsson, a name which translates as Refr of the Temple Farms, son of Gest. Yeah, his father had been a guest and was not known otherwise. Now, Steinunn was also a poet in her own right, and one of the few female skalds whose poetry, albeit only two verses, have been preserved in writing. She composed the verses as a way of letting a Christian missionary know that her lord, Thor, the thunder god, had crushed his ship and was, therefore, stronger than Christ. And she had sort of made that storm, that shipwreck happen by praying or making poetry to Thor. So Steinunn, in this story, was the only representative of the pagan faith that these missionaries could not outwit in any way. So Steinunn was a real historical person, we know this, and she was mentioned in three saga sources, Njål's saga, Kristni saga, and Landnomabók. In Landnomabók, the book about the settling of Iceland, she is listed as the niece of a pagan priest, Jörleif Godi, whose sister was Finna, which means the Sami woman, married to Refr the Great. Refr the Great. And they had Steinunn, who was the mother of Refr of the Temple Farms by a certain guest. In Kristni saga, which is a saga about the conversion to Christianity, we hear that the Saxon missionary Thangbrand had his ship wrecked and that Steinunn composed a verse about it, and we are then given the verses. But in Njål's saga, we get more detail, so I have chosen to quote from that one, because this is the one where Steinunn claims that she actually caused that shipwreck by making poetry to Thor. So, Steinunn skald in Brennunjål's saga, chapter 100. There was a change of rulers in Norway. Earl Håkon had passed away, and in his place came Olaf Tryggvason, king of Norway, between 995 and 1000 AD, and the second king who attempted to convert Norway to Christianity. So we're back in the time of Olaf Tryggvason again, the time of Eivind Kelda and all that. The end of Earl Håkon's life came when the slave Kark cut his throat at Rimul in Gaulardal. Along with this came the news of a change of religion in Norway. So with Earl Håkon was the last, sort of represented the last stronghold of paganism in Norway. So after this, the conversion was happening faster. It says in the saga, they had given up their old faith. This is probably a bit exaggerated because more than half the population was still pagan and did not convert until sometime after 1030 AD, 35 years later. But it was beginning to happen. The Christians began to have a lot of confidence. And I continue reading. The king, Olaf Tryggvason, had also converted the western lands to Christianity, the Shetlands, Orkney, and the Faroe Islands. Many people in Iceland were saying, and Njål heard them, that it was a great scandal to reject the old faith. That autumn, a ship came into Berufjord in Iceland, in the east, and landed at a place called Gautavik. Thangbrand, that was the missionary, was the name of the skipper. He was the son of Count Vilbaldus of Saxony and had been sent out here to Iceland by King Olaf Tryggvason to preach the faith, the Christian faith. With him was an Icelander called Gudleif, who was the son of Hogni Ari, the son of Mar, the son of Atli, the son of Ulf the Squinter, the son of Hogni the White, the son of Otrygg, the son of Oblaud, the son of King Jørleif the Womanizer in Hordaland. Yeah, he could count his lineage back a long way. Gudleif, and this was important in these days, because they're trying to show Thangbrand and Gudleif in a very good light, because they were one of the people who brought Christianity to Iceland. So they want to show that Gudleif really, while Thangbrand was a foreigner from England, Gudleif at least was a man of great standing with a long and royal lineage from Hordaland. And I read, Gudleif was a great warrior and very brave, tough in every way. And on they go to praise these people. Chapter 101. The following spring, Thangbrand traveled around preaching the faith, and Hall went with him. And what follows is an account of how Thangbrand and Hall encountered many pagan enemies of the Christian faith and conquered them all in diverse ways, all until they met with Steinund Skald. Chapter 102. Hjalti and Gisur the White went abroad that summer. Thangbrand's ship, the Bison, was wrecked off Bulandsnes in the east. Thangbrand travelled through all the western parts of the land. Steinun, the mother of Ref the poet, came to meet him. She preached heathenism at a great length to Thangbrand. Thangbrand was silent while she spoke, but then spoke at length and turned all her arguments upside down. "Have you heard," she said, "that Thor challenged Christ to a duel, and that Christ didn't dare to fight with him?" "What I have heard," said Thangbrand, "is that Thor would be mere dust and ashes if God didn't want him to live." "Do you know," she said, "who wrecked your ship?" "What can you say about it?" he said. "I will tell you," she said. "The shaping gods drove ashore the ship of the Keeper of Bells." That would be Thangbrand's ship. "The slayer of the son of the giantess," that would be Thor, "smashed Bison, the ship, on the seagull's rest," the sea. So again, the shaping gods drove ashore the ship of Thangbrand. Thor smashed the ship on the sea. "No help came from Christ when the seahorse, the ship, was crushed. I don't think God was guarding Gylfi's reindeer, the ship, at all." And Steinun spoke another verse. "Thor drove Thangbrand's beast of Thvinnil far from its place." So Thor drove the ship far from its place. "He shook and shattered the ship and slammed it ashore. Never will that oak, the ship, of Atal's field, the sea, never will that sea be up to sea. Never will that ship be up to seafaring again. The storm sent by Thor smashed it so hard into bits." With that, Steinun and Thangbrand parted, and Thangbrand and his men went west to Bardastrandr. And this was all for today. Thank you.
Sjåvarkenningar. Vernig skal sækenna. Svå at kalla han ymis blod. Heimsæker godana. Ver rånar. Fadir ægis døttra. Deira svå heita. Himingleva. Dufa. Blodughadda. Hefring. Uder. Hrønn. Bylgja, Båra, Kolga, land rånar och ägis döttra. Nafnatulur, trollkonur. Skall ek trollkvenna tälja heiter. Grider och gnissa, gryla och brya, glumra, geitla, grima och bakrauf, voma. Gestilja, grottin, tanna. Gjolp, hyrokin, hengi, kefta. Gneip och gneppja, göjsa, håla, hörn och hruga. Hardgreip, forad, hrygda, vedra och hölga bruder. Hrimgerder, hära, hersja, fåla, imd, jornsaxa, ima. Fjölvör, mörn, ividja, omgärder, simul, siver, skrisha, sveipinfalda. Öflugbarda, och Jörn Glumra, Ymgerdr, Åma och Jörn Vidja, Margerdr, Atla, Eisurfåla, Leiken, Munharpa och Myrkrida, Leirvör, Ljota och Lodinfingra, Kråka, Vardrun och Tjallandi, Vigglöd, Thurbörd, William Nefna, Rygi Sidast och Rifingöflu. Skallek Valkyria tälja heiti, en är du ödrar, Odins möjar, Hildir och Göndul, Hlöck, Mist, Skögul, då är Hrund och Eir, Hrist, Skuld talit. Nornir heita, där är Naudskapa, Nift och Disi, nu munek tälja.